that the women should lower the gaze. It's a pity that Raja Ram Mohan Roy, he might not have read these verses. God willing, if Raja Ram Mohan Roy would have read these verses, even he would have told that the woman should wear the veil. 4 years back, I appreciated the Home Minister L.K. Advani for suggesting that the rapist should put to death. Maybe the next Home Minister, he would advise that the women of India should wear the veil.
Yes, brother. Can you state your name and profession?
Assalamu alaikum. Yes. My name is Afroz Wasaya. I am a manager in a private limited company. I would like to put one question. It is a common belief of all the religion that God can do everything. Then why can't he become human being?
The brother posed the question that all the religions believe that God can do anything and everything. So why can't he become a human being? Most of the religions besides Islam, they believe in a philosophy known as anthropomorphism. That means Almighty God, he takes human forms. And they believe in the philosophy that Almighty God is so holy, he doesn't know the shortcomings of human beings. How will a human being feel when he's hurt? How will a human being feel when he's in trouble or in problem? So Almighty God has come down in this world and become a human being to set the rules for the human being. On the face of it, it's a very good logic. But I tell these people that suppose I manufacture a VCR. Do I have to become a VCR to know what is good or what is bad for the VCR? Since I'm the creator, I don't have to become a VCR. I just write an instruction manual that if you want to play the VCR video cassette recorder, put in the video cassette and press the play button. If you want to fast forward, press the FF button. If you want to stop, press the stop button. Don't drop it from a height, it will get spoiled. Don't immerse it in water, it will get damaged. I'll write an instruction manual. Similarly, Almighty God, since he is the creator of the human being, he does not have to become a human being to know what is good or what is bad for the human being. What does he do? He chooses a man amongst men and he reveals the revelation. And the last and final revelation for the human beings, it is the glorious Quran, the do's and don'ts. If I agree with you for sake of argument that Almighty God can do anything and everything, so why can't he become a human being? If I agree with you for sake of argument that God can do anything and everything, that he can even become a human being, if God becomes a human being, he ceases to be God. Because God and human beings have got different qualities. Almighty God, he is immortal. Human beings are mortal. You can't have a person who's immortal and mortal at the same time. God has got no beginning. Human beings have a beginning. You can't have a person who has a beginning and no beginning at the same time. Almighty God has got no end. Human beings have an end. You can't have a person who has an end and no end at the same time. It's meaningless. So either you can have God or you can have man. You can't have a God-man. It doesn't make sense. Human beings, we require to eat. Almighty God does not require to eat. Allah says in Surah An'am chapter 6 verse number 14, Almighty God feedeth everyone but does not require to be fed. We human beings require rest and sleep. Almighty God does not require rest. If I agree with you for sake of argument, Almighty God can do anything and everything, in that same argument, Almighty God can even tell a lie. It is ungodly to tell a lie. The moment God tells lie, he ceases to be God. If I agree with you, God can do everything, God Almighty can even be unjust. But the moment God does injustice, he ceases to be God. Allah says in the Quran, Surah Nisa, chapter number 4, verse 40, that Almighty God is never unjust in the least degree. If Almighty God wants, he can forget. But to forget is ungodly. Allah says in Surah Taha, chapter 20, verse 52, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never forgets. The moment Almighty God forgets, he ceases to be God. If Almighty God wants, he can make a mistake. But to make a mistake is ungodly. Allah says in Surah Taha, chapter 20, verse 52, that Almighty God never makes a mistake. The moment God makes a mistake, he ceases to be God. Nowhere in the Quran it is mentioned that God can do everything. What Allah says in the Quran in Surah Fatir, chapter 35, verse number 1, is Inna Allah ala kulli shay'in qadir. That verily Allah has power over all things. It's mentioned in several places. In Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 106. In Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 109. In Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 284. In Surah Imran, chapter number 3, verse 29. In Surah Nahl, chapter 16, verse 77. In Surah Fatir, chapter 35, verse number 1, Allah says, Inna Allah ala kulli shay'in qadir. For verily Allah has power over all things. Allah says in Surah Buruj, chapter number 85, verse number 16, that Allah is the doer of all He intends. Whatever He intends, He can do. But Almighty God will never intend telling a lie, will never intend making a mistake. He will never intend becoming a human being. He will only intend things which are godly. Hope that answers the question.
Next question from the brother on my left.
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Atif Sumar. I'm a student. And my question is that Hindu scholars, well, when they're doing idol worship, they claim that they're just worshipping the Almighty God, but the idols are just for concentration. So, according to Islam, is it allowed? Is this allowed?
The brother asked the question that the Hindu scholars, they agree that idol worship is wrong. But to concentrate on Almighty God, the idol is only used for concentration. They agree God has got no images, but they use for concentration. So is it right? All these Hindu scholars, they have read the Hindu scriptures, and the scholars agree that Almighty God has got no images. But what they say, that those people who have lower consciousness, they require an idol for concentration. Once you reach a higher level of consciousness, then idol is not required. So I tell these pundits and scholars that those people who have higher consciousness, they don't require an idol to concentrate. So we Muslims have already reached that higher level of consciousness. We don't require any idols to concentrate. Furthermore, once the pundit told me that when we speak to children, we have to make them understand easily. If your child asks you, why does it thunder? So we give the reply that I macha ki pistiye. It is thundering because I macha ki pistiye, grandmother in the heaven, she is grinding flour. I told him, in Islam, we don't agree in telling a lie, even if it's a white lie. If I tell my son that it thunders because I macha ki pistiye, and when he goes to school, he learns that thundering is due to sudden expansion of rapidly heated air, he will start thinking that my father is telling a lie. What we have to know, we have to speak the truth. The pundits and the scholars, they say that at the lower level, the idol is required for concentration. At a higher level, we don't require concentration. Like how if we study at the lower standard one, it's required, higher level is not required. I tell them that suppose we teach mathematics. In standard 2, when we teach mathematics, we say 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. But the same 2 plus 2 is equal to 4 remains in 10th standard, remains when he does his graduation, it even remains when he does a PhD. The basic teaching of any subject remains the same. 2 plus 2 will remain the same irrespective of its 2nd standard or 10th standard or graduation or PhD. It is very clear that in the Vedas, in the Hindu scriptures, Almighty God has got no images. It is the basics. You can't change your basic. If someone tells me that in standard 2, 2 plus 2 is equal to 5, so you can't tell your son, don't worry, when you reach standard 10, I will tell you 2 plus 2 is not equal to 5. You have to correct him immediately. So it's the duty of all the Hindu scholars to tell the Hindus that according to the Hindu scriptures, Almighty God has got no images. That's the basic. So even at the basic level, they should preach to their followers that idol worship is wrong. Hope that answers the question.
The next question, which is the fourth question of the day and the first on the slip, is by Brother Rohit Shah. He asks, if Islam is the religion of peace, then why does it preach the concept of jihad, that is fighting and killing the kafir? In fact, Hinduism is the religion of peace.
The brother has asked a very important question, that if Islam is the religion of peace, why does it preach about jihad, that is fighting and killing the kafir? In fact, Hinduism is the religion of peace. There's a great misconception as far as jihad in Islam is concerned. This misconception is not only among the non-Muslims, it even among the Muslims. They think that any war fought by any Muslim for any reason, whether it be for personal gain, whether it be for fame, whether it be for money, any war fought by any Muslim is jihad. Jihad does not mean any war fought by any Muslim. Jihad comes from the Arabic word jahada, which means to strive, which means to struggle. In Islamic context, it means to strive against one's own evil inclination. It also means to strive to make the society better. It also means to strive in the battlefield in self-defense. It also means to fight against tyrant and oppression. Jihad basically means to strive, it means to struggle. And very often the critics of Islam, even the Hindu critics, even Arun Shuri, he writes in his book, The World of Fatwa, and he quotes Surah Tawbah chapter number 9 verse number 5, and it says that the Quran mentions, wherever you find a kafir, into bracket Hindus, wherever you find a kafir, you kill them. And if you open the Quran, and if you read in this Quran, chapter number 9, verse number 5, it does say that wherever you find a kafir, you kill him. But it is a quotation out of context. For the context, read a few verses previous. The first few verses of Surah Tawbah speaks about a peace treaty between the Muslims and the mushriks of Makkah. This peace treaty was unilaterally broken by the mushriks of Makkah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by the time he reaches verse number 5, he gives the ultimatum to the enemies, to the mushriks of Makkah. You put things straight in 4 months' time, otherwise the declaration of war. And in the battlefield, Allah says to the Muslims, wherever you find the enemies, wherever you find the kafir, you kill them. This verse of the Quran is talking about the battlefield. When the Muslims are fighting for truth, against falsehood, against the enemy, if they come to attack you, don't get scared, kill them. Any army general, to boost up the morale of the soldiers, will say that kill the enemy. He will not say